I'm Jill Hartz, the Executive Director of the Jordan Schnitzer Museum of Art. And with Daniel Knapp, who's a co-curator of this exhibition, we want to thank you so much for coming and for being part of what has been just a fabulous exhibition and series of programs in honor of Rick and his work. So this is the final program, and the show will close after August 9th. So make sure that you come see it, tell others. I will travel to other museums over about 2 or 3 years, and you can check our website for the venue so you can tell your friends around the country not to miss this. Of course, there's the catalog, so if you don't have a catalog yet, you can get that. And there are even some note cards as well that we've produced recently, so and a poster, other things. So you can, you know, remember this occasion in many ways. We are also taping this, so we have a number of our talks that are on our YouTube channel, so you can keep checking that, and this will be on there as well. So in case you know people who wanted to come and couldn't come, tell them to just check in on that one. So Rick and Barry are longtime friends. They deeply admire one another's work, and they share a way of looking at and responding to the world that is sure to make this a thoughtful and enlightening presentation. I should say that they will converse for about an hour. We'll see where this goes, and then we'll open it up for all of us to engage in that conversation as well. So we have no hard, fast times. We'll see how it goes. If you find for some reason you can't hear, let us know. We want to make sure that, you know, everyone can hear and sees what's going on. And I probably don't need to read their bios, but I will, just because they're eminent people. Barry is an essayist, author, and short story writer. Born in 1945 in Port Chester, New York, he grew up in Southern California and New York City before moving to Oregon in 1968. He is a year younger than Rick. No, older. You're older. Sorry, you're older. Sorry.
I knew she was.
Okay. He is the author of 14 books at last count, including Arctic Dreams, for which he received the National Book Award, and 6 collections of short stories. He is the recipient of numerous literary and cultural awards and is currently the visiting distinguished scholar at Texas Tech University. He lives on the Upper Mackenzie River with his wife, the writer Deborah Gordney, and we're pleased to have Deborah with us today. Active as a landscape photographer prior to 1981, Barry has close ties with a diverse community of artists and has written about, among others, Alan McGee, Lillian Pipp, who is also here tonight, or today, thank you Lillian for coming, Richard Rowland, and Rick, whom he describes as his, quote, longtime friend, advisor, and collaborator. Rick Bartow is one of our nation's most prominent contemporary Native American artists. He was born in Newport, Oregon in 1946, so he is a year younger. He is a member of the Wyoc tribe in Northern California and has close ties with the Celeste community. He graduated in 1969 from Western Oregon University with a degree in secondary arts education and soon after served in the Vietnam War. His work is permanently held in more than 60 public institutions around the country and the world, including many, many eminent ones, including ours. And he has had 35 solo exhibitions, and his art is literally referenced in hundreds of books, catalogs, and articles. So this whole project is the result of so many people, many of whom are in this room. I want to also point out Charles Froelich. We could not have done this without you, Charles. Charles is a great friend of Rick's and ours and his gallerist.
He's younger.
He's younger. Yeah. How much?
Big time.
Yeah, how much younger is that? So I also want to do a call out to all the institutions and funding supporters that have really let us do this project as we envisioned, because it's so rare. I mean, you can actually present something the way you want to present it with the catalog of programs and everything. A special thank you to the Ford Family Foundation and the Oregon Community Foundation, Arlene Schnitzer, the Coit and Donald Barker Changing Exhibitions Endowment, the Harold and Arlene Schnitzer Care Foundation, the Oregon Arts Commission and the National Endowment for the Arts, the Ballinger Endowment, Philip and Sandra Peely, and so many of our members. There are other gifts as well, but all of them really enabled us to make this happen. So without further ado, please join me in thanking our special guests for being here, and you can take it away.
It's so easy for us to slip into feeling bad. And look how fun we can make fun of. If you get one old fool just can get up down the street, we can still laugh. And it's good for your heart. And it's good for your mind. All the way around. So I hope that in the days coming our way that we won't forget how about humor and laughing. I have a wonderful thing to start before I stop. My part of today is very short. Oh, my friend's dog's is Gabby, I forgot. I'm farther along than my late father because he carried one, but it was always empty. He said it was something about remembering to put it in his pocket. That's about all the further it got. But I read this and I like. I have trouble. I have brain damage, and it's starting to show because I didn't have any cookies after we got done. But I love this line. The part of our cognitive repertoire as we dispersed from Africa. The part of our cognitive repertoire. I wish I had said that. Our cognitive patterns. Our brain, that we are so different and so same. And we are so lucky, so very lucky to be able to find and sit around and eat and drink water and tea and coffee and sit and talk about Deborah and Barry in our midst today, that we can find humor as well as intelligence. One may have more than the other, but I'm younger. But not as young as Charles Foley. Cognitive. Sometimes it seems like cognitive sometimes overshadows humor sometimes. Mm-hmm. And I think that there's a good place for every place, but I think we need to study as much about cognitive, about the humor, things that happen. I thought you were going to show my pictures. I came out here from the coast. Barry's been working on manuscripts. I've been working on some small paintings, trying to get over depression of the doctors trying to figure out which way to fix my heart. And there's, okay, my heart is okay, but the other heart needs patching. So I decided that was enough of that time. I see it over there now, yeah, I found it. So, so to get over that, I started working into the paint, into the images, and that's more than I was going to give away, because I forgot to write it down because it was very lengthy about Picasso talking about some erotic drawings that he created of a young, beautiful woman and a dumpy, pot-bellied old man with a mask. And he said that it was so confounding. The work couldn't really be described because it was just too much stuff going on, which I thought was a good way to get out of it. I don't think I'm getting very far, Barry.
What should we do?
Well, we talked about before that we could just be quiet for an hour.
Yeah.
And it would confound you so much that you wouldn't be able to really understand what we were giving you. It begins with a mist myth, maybe, or it begins with a miss, M-E-S-S, mess. And then looking through the mess of marks and colors to try to find something that makes sense out of it. Most of the time now, without my brains all working, there's more opportunities for humor than not, because you never know what's going to come out of my mouth. So that's just my way of apologizing now of anything else that I say, because when I'm trying to be jocose, sometimes terrible things will come out of my mouth. So I think that maybe what Barry should do now is to make a mess verbally and see if he can think to make it make sense out of some trail ends. Something new. Something new.
Thanks.
Yeah.
I'll dig.
You want me to work the middle now?
Yeah. Or just go for a walk.
Okay, yeah. And holler back across the camera.
Yes, we've done that before.
Yeah.
Well, one thing I was wondering if we could talk about is, you and I come from different worlds. You know, we grew up in different circumstances. One person is an artist, one person is a writer. And for all these years, since Lillian brought us together, we seem to be on the same road. And so I wonder what it is that is coming through both of us that turns into this penetrating work that you do, and I hope for me turns into beautiful language and story. But we've both agreed that something doesn't belong to us is coming through us, and our work is to be in service, to shape it, to work through the mess and make something that's comprehensible. So the place I want to go with this is animals. I called one group of animals wild animals all of my life, you know, and a senior man to me, Oren Lyons, Onondaga man. I was on the phone with him the other night and he said, "Oh, you mean free animals, not wild." And I think those are the animals that either look for us or we look for them and listen to them, and then they rise up through us. And I wanted to ask you, who are you listening to now that you couldn't hear 20 years ago? Is there somebody new that's come to see you?
I think it's perhaps a very similar one, but more intimate, more closely.
Mm-hmm.
So we look for words, but when we're younger, we're a little busy, too much piss and vinegar. Don't pay attention.
Mm.
But now we slow down and we actually begin to see faces and eye to eye, I think.
Yeah, well, we've both been slowed down.
Yeah.
So that's another conversation we never have had about what now, you know, when we're almost the same age.
Yeah. I'm younger.
Yeah, somewhere I heard that. I feel that I was so much that I had presented to me, I was too young, running too fast, missed it. And now in memory I can come back to it and turn it over and talk with it, and out of that intimacy comes a story, or at least comes language. You've been way inside. You know, you gone really deep into your own self, Vietnam years and a lot of crazy time after that. I don't know if I ever had the courage to do that, to go inside myself. I'm always looking out there, and it's all symbols and what you're attracted to, but it's been really a brave life for you to be fearless about going in and discovering the troubled side of the world and bringing it out and putting it on a canvas. And do you remember one time I, this was years ago, and I said I could not understand why you were not collected by more people, that your work was in, not in the homes of more people. And you said to me, people love to look at it in a museum, but they're afraid to have it in the home. And I think that that's true, because what you paint is so terrifying, but it's also part of us. And we like to see it as long as it's a little bit at arm's length. But when those images are right there in your face all the time, then you have to make the same journey as a viewer that you've made as a painter. And most of us don't want to do it. It's too hard. Price is too high. So there's a curious way to me in which neither you nor I thinks about what we're supposed to do as an artist or a writer. We just do what comes through us. But both of us are trying to serve a community. And one way you serve this community is by showing us the things that we're afraid of in a shape that we can accept we as a starting point to look into our own lives. So my question for you is, what is our community? What is the community that we have, all these people that we've named, Lillian and Charles, and you know, we wouldn't be anywhere without these people. I wouldn't be anywhere without Deborah and my grandson there, my brother. So what is it that we're on the outside? You know, we're on the outside in some way, not quite fitting in. That's historically what people like us have been like. And we're always trying to integrate ourselves in the community. So what's our community? What is that now?
I think right now it's a very dangerous time.
Yeah.
Because I think there's, again, if we had a little more laughter than we did more of horror that we daily bathe in terror. And yet, it's the same world that it ever was.
Yeah.
Thinking about a truth that I will tell you and won't tell again. My stepdad was very sick. He was starting to transition. And I used to walk a certain walk down along the bay there. And this one time I leant forward, and suddenly a strange thing happened, and I was going inside the back of my wounded stepfather. So I was halfway in and halfway out, standing along the road, wishing that I could change things, somehow that I could make him live, because I knew he wasn't going to make it. And there I was, a picker in between, and a big, huge, massive scar in his back. And I went in through that, inside of him, could see inside. And I realized halfway in that it wasn't my job.
Hmm.
It's not my job okay, I don't know what to do when I'm in there. What can I do? I can find myself in a strange, unbelievable situation, but I'm not able to move it. That's for the other people that know how to do that. The community is kind of the same way at the time. We've become a certain age that we've become a little fragile. We're not quite as cocky about tomorrow. And so we begin kind of fractioning a little bit, taking care of who's close to us. It's harder to involve our hands to say, please come, you might be the one who kills us all. We have a strange day. That's no different of strange me entering into my stepfather's body. Once you go so far, you can bear your love, you can bear it. And I think that's about as far as you're going to get with it, because that's what we have to offer. Instead of terror, to say love. And the passion of red, mauve, hot stuff, cold things, cool colors, coals that excite us, coals that makes us cold. I myself don't have my own work in the house. I don't like it. That somebody else could have it. I have other people that I like better. So I don't need to worry about that.
There's something about going into places where you're afraid. And I think from the outside, sometimes people think, how can you go in there? That's so dangerous. But it doesn't occur to you. It doesn't occur to me. That's where I'm meant to go. And all I care about is coming out alive and making something beautiful out of what I found in there. And in that way, I think there's so many ways that the arts operate in with the same kind of methodology. We have this phrase, artists and writers. And the writers are separated out, I think, because we're the most literal of the arts. But you do the same thing, I think, as a writer. I do the same thing as a writer as you do as a painter. I'm looking for a pattern. And what to intellectualize about it would be damaging, the worst thing that I could do. I'm just listening for a rhythm of language that makes something happen that is not on the page, but in the story. And when I'm on the inside of that phenomenon, I know I'm doing the same thing as a friend of mine who's a composer. I'm just making a pattern out of tonal values, or a choreographer is making a pattern out of a movement in three dimensions. You're working on flat surfaces and three-dimensional surfaces, making a pattern, and somebody else comes along and says, well, that's a this. Okay, I'm not interested. I mean, the artist, I don't think, is ever interested in trying to teach somebody something. You just want to show and basically say, what do you think? You know, but what you think isn't anything. I can't imagine that I could, that you would make a definitive statement about a painting. You wouldn't be interested in doing that, or it would be not something you wanted to be around. And I would say the same thing with a short story that I wrote. You know, there are people in the story that are doing something in a pattern, and I'm trying to bring it out and then say, well, there it is, and what do you think? And that's that halfway place I think you were talking about. You're in something for which there is no language. And when you come out and you have to talk about it, it gets to be really difficult.
Yeah.
You can't, I learned a lot of things traveling with traditional people, but one of them was to just shut up. You know, and what I mean by that is if you're moving in a landscape, lots of things are going on, you know, butterflies are coming around and wind is moving through leaves and water is burbling over rocks and somebody's watching you that you can feel but you can't see, so there's lots going on, and the moment you try to put language on it, it's gone. The moment you try to collapse all of that into language, the moment you try to give it meaning, it disappears. So we're trying to come through some kind of back door. You know, you're trying to come through the back door as a painter. I'm trying to come through the back door. You have these paints and charcoal and you have the tools that you use. And I use the different tools. But we're just trying to, I think sometimes we're just trying to coax something out of what we encounter and make it beautiful. Make all the pieces fit together. So when somebody comes up to it, they say, oh, this all fits together. I want to be here. And if we do the work historically, I think that we should do, that's our part in the community, is to help women and men who are much more skilled at going in that body you were talking about. They know what to do in there. But if we can make them feel a sense of worth and a sense of possibility, then that's what we do in the community. Just try to elevate people that are competent to take care of us. You know, we're looking at 70 degree water in the lower Willamette, and Chinook are dying. We have global climate change, ocean acidification. Hell is coming. Hell is coming. And what are we doing? What are we doing? We're trying to make something that helps people way smarter than we are, way younger too.
Yeah.
We're trying to help them. That's what I want to. I just want to be in service to whatever this thing is that moves through us and make it happen for people when they read or when they walk in that museum and look at what you've painted. We're just in service to the people we love, and it really is about love. You fall in love with the idea of the person that you'll be able to make an intimate contact with through a story or through a painting.
I think about Dangul, the bear, and the idea of the bear, and the same story where we hear, in my head I hear that old coupling or something in the back of the truck. Clunk. It's everything and nothing.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the bear cleaning up for somebody else again in my mind when I heard that.
Yes.
He was doing something in one of Barry's stories where the bear is cleaning up, throwing metal scrap. And you just hear the clunk. We used to have the old man and I had the bear behind us. She never got in front of us, she'd always go behind us, so we'd get scared a little bit because we'd turn around and there'd be a pile there. So she'd been there since we'd gone through. It was just kind of a trick of the bear. We never could see her, we could hear her. He always required a good smell, but I had chili in. It wasn't the bear, it was I. I tried to tell him, but he, in his elder wisdom, knew that he could smell a fart, a bear when he a bear.
I was with a friend one time on Khrushchev Island, Alaska. We were looking for animals and food, and really heavy taiga forest, you know. So we're right next to the beach, and we shoulder our way out of these trees, and right there in front of us, no further away than you, were grizzly bear footprints. And when we looked at them, we could see the sand going into the footprint.
Yeah, pretty fresh.
Yeah, my friend Richard turned to me and he said, well, what do you think about it? Being back in the food chain again. Close. They give you humor. You know, I know that bear could have been thinking, watch these two guys. There'll be a laugh. You know, you see the cubs around, they're looking around, you know, look at those two fools watching the sand go in the footprint. Then there was a kind of odor, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It had been me leaving.
I went out. This story that Rick was referring to was, Deborah and I have lived way up Mackenzie River for years. And I've seen a lot of older men, loggers, who've broken down to work in the woods, but they're still active and they want to be a part of things. So I imagined this character, story is called Pulling Wire. And this man's wife had passed away, and he went up every day into these old landings, and he'd look for scrap metal, chokers and gears and crown blocks and anything that was lying around. He'd pick it up and put it in his truck, and he'd take it into Eugene and sell it for scrap. But he mostly was thinking about how many trees he'd cut, and he wanted to go back and clean it up. He wanted to go back, and he thought of it like pulling a splinter out of the earth. So that's what he did with his time. And there's some other parts of the story, but what Rick was referring to is he was on a landing one time with his pickup, just paused there, and a bear came with a great big piece of metal, just reached up and could thunk, put it in the truck, and went away. I think that, you know, the animals have given us everything. In the beginning, they gave us food and their skins for shelter and their bones for tools. They gave us everything. And they're still doing that, I think. But we have not been kind to them. And I see that sometimes in all these bears that are in your drawings and paintings. Kind of angry about what's happened. Nobody listened.
Yeah, I've got really good friends that shoot bears. And they'll either leave them or maybe dress them out and feed them to the dogs. Perfectly really normal people, but somewhere they kind of went off the tracks somehow. Bigger gun, better. I don't know.
I just read a long poem called I, Snow Leopard. It was written by a well-known Chinese poet, Ji Munchao. And we're going to get it published here in English this fall. I wrote a little introduction for it. But the idea behind the poem is really powerful to me. This man, G.D. Manja, is traditional Chinese, Yi Chinese, not Han Chinese. And he's internationally known poet. He's also very highly placed in the Han government. So his own people are a little bit mistrustful of him because he's so acceptable to the Han Chinese. And the Han Chinese are a little bit concerned about him because his background is a traditional background. So he was the right man to write this poem about essentially an elder, a snow leopard. The snow leopard says a lot of things in the poem, but one of the things the snow leopard, who has the voice of an elder, says is, don't get it in your head that you're going to be able to make it without us. What's going to happen to you is going to happen to us, and what's happening to us, it will happen to you. We're in this like a brother and a sister. Very powerful piece. And when I was reading it, I thought, so this is something that's coming from China. From China. And I find these stories now all over the world. It's not like everybody's thinking the same thing, but many people are waking up to what's happening to them is going to happen to us. And that's one of the lessons about all the Chinook that died in 70 degree water in the lower Willamette. That stuff is coming for everybody. The things that we're afraid of are indifferent when it comes to whether it's a person or a snow leopard. So taking care of them and bringing them into the community to have their counsel, it's just smart. And traditional people all over the world have known that for 50,000 years, pick a time. But we think we can get away. I think we can get away with just using them up and we'll be okay. That's the logic of lunatics. So I think so much of what happens to you and what happens to me is brought by those salmon. Or you remember the time we sat at your place and looked out over that swamp? Oh my God. I need help.
You broke it, Barry.
I broke it?
As you age.
Yeah. It's coming for you in a year, Bartow. Good.
One person, now maybe two.
So remember when we were sitting in your place and we're sitting on the back porch and maybe you were playing a little bit on the guitar, we were just yapping. And you were telling me about these beaver that were in that swamp out there and being a kid and how much that meant to you to be older and be there in a place where that energy and narrative was still available to you. It was there for you when you were a boy and then there it's now for you as an adult, a painter with a history, Vietnam. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do remember that out there. So it's, there are some places that are completely, that haven't changed at all. Or we used to play up in the hills up there. But I remember the one time I ever really saw my old uncle cry was when they clear cut the last cedar stand. About a mile back from the house. You could hear it from the house. But he went back and they were all down and cleared and cried there. Remember it had a spirit. As kids, my cousins and I, we had to roam of the place. We could go anywhere we wanted. But the one place when it came late, we got the hell out of the cedar grove. Because it seemed like you could hear people talking in there. Because that sue of the sun or the wind in those little leaves of theirs, you know. We didn't like it. It scared us, and we got the hell out of there. It was getting later in the afternoon. We didn't like to be around that cedar stand there, because it, and, you know, as kids, we could get a hold of it better. You know, we were young, and we could still hear them talking in there. Maybe not as words, but we could hear them talking, and it scared us. And we didn't want to be around there, because we didn't understand it, but we could feel it. All of those magic places are gone. They're in my mind. Other people have taken over that never knew, and I sort of think that they never will know the mystery and the magic of those wonderful things.
Do you think that there's a way to restore what seems to be lost through art? What is it about your work that is restorative, or that I find restorative? What's going on there?
I know, I have trouble with that, because I remember you calling me in the morning and telling me 911 had happened. My recall of it was that you said we needed artists more than we ever did.
Yeah.
He's right in art now. And I still think over those things of how can we get over that? How can we get by that? Except to say that we keep going. You know, and now I found religion, you know. I found the red road, you know, which is the native way of spirituality, and the sweat house, and the elders have taught us there and teach to us now, that revivifies the mystery.
Yeah.
And it's back to like the title of this show, which I didn't vote for. I thought it was too lengthy. I wanted to call it work. Even if my brain goes softer, I can still write work. But things that, you know, that are that we can't explain, you know, that we can't explain. I think that old German guy was pretty smart when he said that, because if we think about so many things, about mysteries and things in our family, that we come right up with something that's just darn near concrete, and yet we can't explain it, and we can't get rid of it. It's just there, and it's in. We could almost think we could touch it, but we can't, because it's truth. But beyond truth, it's mystery. Sometimes we have trouble understanding truth. I think that we wiggle around too much with truth. Mm. It's pretty hard to take a mouthful of truth. It's just damn hard. So we wiggle around and try to find an edge on it. But in the end, mystery, it sustains us sometimes when we don't even realize how far can we get full of a mouthful of mystery. Can't get rid of it. You can't discuss it.
Mm.
People have whole, you know, lives and religions and things about it, but it still comes down to it. Nobody's just nailed it right down yet. Still living, but you can't see it.
I think about this distinction when you see something powerful in the non-made world, in the so-called natural world, the possibility is for two responses. One is analysis, explaining the thing, and the other is awe. And we've taught ourselves that the proper response to mystery is analysis, and missed the major part of human history, which is the profound and long-lived response to mystery is awe.
Yeah.
That
yeah.
Awe is not a, it doesn't mean you're ignorant or incapable of comprehending complexity. It means that you choose to be in an elevated state with something that in the end is inexplicable.
Mm-hmm.
And what you want to do is be a part of it. And this makes me think that there's something about, I think for many people living in a chaos of, I don't know, emails and all the stuff that goes on in your life, and wanting that thing that's cool water, just some moment of peace. And that's what art provides. It's restorative because it shows you coherence in a beautiful way. In any work of art that's worth your attention, there is nothing extraneous. Everything fits together. Everything that's there belongs. What's not there shouldn't be there anyway. So when you expose yourself to that, it becomes restorative because of the chaos that's inside of you. And that's why it's, you know, the cool drink of water, that cliche. So there must be a way now and historically in which art functioned as that it restored order in the interior of the person present to it, the same way that certain things you encounter in the land restore a sense of bearing. You know again where it is that you meant to go, what you meant to do with your life. And I would go so far, I don't really like the word, but I'd go so far as to say that there is buried deep in our tissues a sense of moral order.
Mm.
And art includes you again and helps you understand what it is that you wish to be, what it is that you're yearning after, which is not a job or, you know, something ridiculous like that. It's what you aspire. That's the word, the spiritus. What you aspire to be is reflected to you, back to you, when you confront a piece of art that is created by somebody who's not trying to sell you anything. Is just saying, here we are, here's our humanity, and is this going to be it? Is a bunch of fish dead in the lower river, is that going to be it? That's going to be what we say at the end? Or are we going to say something different? We all want to say something different than what's going on, but I when I said that to you, when I called you on the morning of 9/11 and said we need artists now more than we ever have in the past, is because that is within the capacity of artists and writers to do, to tell a story or make a painting that helps a person remember what it is they meant to do with their lives, to remember what they stand for and what they want for their children and how they wish to conduct themselves, and that the anger they feel about the way government, to pick something, conducts itself, that's a good anger. It's a good resentment. And art teaches you that. Art teaches you not to respect everything that you feel you have to wash off your skin at night. That all the pettiness that you encounter, condescending to people because of their race or whatever it is, that stuff is no good, and we know it's no good. And art tells you you're right in thinking this is no good. Here's where to be, here in this coherence.
It's more of the mystery.
Hmm. Should we have some questions?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Come.
So, I think what we'll do.
We're going to work the center now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's use a microphone and I can take it around?
These are the only microphones we have.
Okay.
So yeah, we'll take
that way we can record.
Well, you'll have to answer everything.
Yeah,
so, so maybe we can. So there was a question here.
Thank you for your words. I had two things. One was when you talked about the fish, I wanted to bring ice cubes to the river, or I wanted to bring snow from Boston in a suitcase instead of going on a vacation and putting it in the river, but I know that's ridiculous. The other thing I thought when you talked about the terror of the world and the hell that is to come, that we try to wash off every night in the shower, that your paintings, Rick, seem to have expressed a hell that you went through and came out of, or were processing by things you went through in your life. And that those of us who don't write or paint and are trying to process our hell, I'm tired as heck and I'm not going to take it anymore, sort of stuff. We go and we gaze at the pictures and we feel relief, but still feel stuck in a way, and those are the things that you just made me think about. I don't know if there's any answers for that, but any thoughts?
Well, thank you. I guess the idea would be just to help each other. You know, we're trying to help, I'm sure you are too. That's the only way that we'll be able to be proud of ourselves and have our children proud of us and our grandchildren, is if we learn how to take care of each other. So Rick said earlier, you know, it's really important to be in love. Somebody asked me, and one of those things where you just say something because you don't want them to be talking to you or ask you a question. And I've been able to see a lot of the world, you know, 90-some countries. And somebody said, well, what is it that you learned traveling all over the world? And this is what I blurted out. It's kind of a shallow thing, really, but it has a lot to me now in reflecting on it. I said that it is more important to be in love than to be in power. And that simple idea is one this country still has to learn. We're absolutely obsessed in private and public life with being in power and do not have time to be in love. And that's why I think with every traditional group of people I've ever traveled with, when I say, what do you think about when you think about us? And the answer is almost always the same: lonely. You're a lonely people. Because we decided that somewhere along the line that it's the individual that counts. It is not. You know, you don't need him to paint, you don't need me to write. But if we've done our work, you need those paintings, and you need that story. And after us, there'll be somebody else. You need the story more than the storyteller, I know that. And we need to back away from this idea that somebody, some individual person is indispensable, we can't do it without them. This is our thing with genius, you know, we want this person's a genius, that person's a genius. Probably not. Genius resides in the community. And if you're fortunate, once in a while in your life, you see it in individual woman, individual man. You recognize something that belongs to all of us. So you have your work to do. Rick has his work. I have my work. Everybody has their work. And if we just stick to that and watch for each other, we'll be fine. No matter what comes, we have to take care of each other.
guys. It's always a pleasure hearing your wisdom and your voice. And so, Barry, one time you gave a talk on, was NPR, about, there was one book, he asked you if there is one thing you can tell anybody to read, what would it be? And that was Reverence, the Forgotten Virtue.
Yeah.
And so, and why did you choose that book?
The book that was Bill Moyers, a talk with Bill Moyers, and he said something about picking a book, you know, I mean, goodness, we wrote down 20 titles of books at lunch, but I the book I mentioned is called Reverence, the Rediscovery of a Forgotten Virtue. It's by a man named Paul Woodruff, who teaches in the philosophy department at UT Austin. And I think I chose that book on impulse because it seemed to me that the recovery of a capacity, Paul calls reverence the capacity to recognize what is completely beyond our power to understand or control. But it's not, the important word there is capacity, and the development, the constant attention to the capacity that you have to feel reverence, a part of which is respect, a part of reverence is awe. And I guess I thought in the moment, if we could learn how to do this again, which you can learn, I think, in sojourning with most traditional people I've ever spent time with, they don't have to recover it, they never gave it up. And that capacity would help people understand the moral order that we traded in with the Industrial Revolution and the Agricultural Revolution and all of these revolutions that people in Western culture have had. We traded it all. We traded the capacity to feel reverence in order to get a little bit more powerful. So it just struck me as a good book to sink into and think about and wonder what would happen to me if I felt reverence more often than I felt anger. That's Lillian Pitt. She's, and I don't know, you're younger than we are. But you're like the she is the teacher for these two guys.
E.O. Wilson wrote a book, Consilience, The Unity of Knowledge, in which he talks about that we are drowning in data while starving for wisdom. Seems like that we are totally at a loss for wisdom, and I would suggest that maybe reverence grows out of wisdom. But how do we pass wisdom when we have created a society of retirement that separates those who are supposed to be wise to pass the information on? And how can you talk to that as a bridge between indigenous and modern culture?
Yeah, right. He's looking to answer.
Oh, okay, good.
It's part of our cognitive repertoire.
Hi. You know, Craig, the bridge is there. The bridge is there. Traditional people who aspire to You know, Ed is writing in that book about bringing the sciences and the humanities together. And you can spend time with people who never took them apart. And the bridge is right there at your front door. You just walk over it. There's so many traditional communities that are happy to talk to anybody who listens, who has the capacity to listen. Most white people, most people like us, walk into a village and they have a lot to say. That's the end of that conversation. Because the people that know something worth listening to leave at that time.
Way up in the back.
I just wanted to ask each of you creative, extremely creative people. By the way, I'm oldest. I'm older than both of you.
Keep going.
Yeah. I wondered when you went to that other world to bring it forward in your creative process. If you each, one or the other, felt a feeling of relief as work progressed, or doesn't it come as relief? Does it come as this is your work, and it just is?
Origin of Human Imagination, Adam Brum, B-R-U-M-M, archaeologist. Noticed that there was 41 seashells drilled that they looked like they were going to make a nice little necklace out of them. It's about Christopher and Shilwood, the University of Bergen, found in South Africa, the Bongos caves before 50,000 years. And a 100,000-year-old annual paint brush was found, an animal paint brush done with red ochre, marrow, and an abalone shell palette, charcoal and watercolors, mulberry for colors. Stencils also have brush of hair, made out of hair, the brushes. 75,000 geometric ochre slab carved was engaged. So all these numbers are way beyond when they're finding that the 20th century people in Europe. Then they were talking about the origin of human imagination and also about the part of our cognitive repertoire. I may not have mentioned that to you. Not much on that date that day. Part of it is when I'm thinking more than one thing, I can't hear anything. And I've turned up my hearing aids about maxed out, but I still couldn't say what you said. So I'll just have to tell you that it's part of my cognitive repertoire. Catch up.
If I'm not sure that I understood the question that you had, but an answer was forming while you were speaking, which I hope is in response to the question. Um, I would say for me as a person, the place I feel, I don't know how to phrase this, if I'm in a very chaotic frame of mind, very distressed about whatever it is, something in the family or, you know, the regular stuff that you become anxious about, I find that if there's nothing I can do about it, and I'm working on a manuscript, once I'm back in that world, whatever it is that's bothering me is gone. So that over many years, I anticipate that if I am doing my work well, I'll be okay. And if I'm really in a bad way, I try to be smart enough to go back in front of the typewriter or in a manuscript and just go to work. Just go to work. So I know that there's a sense of safety. And good health in creating work. And most painters, photographers, and other people that I'm close to, everybody knows about that. Your life can be really chaotic. I mean, that's part of the whole thing that goes with being an artist or a writer. But once you're back in that place where you're working hard, you don't even know what time it is. You're okay again. You're okay again.
Okay, one last question. Sorry, she was first.
Rick and Barry, I want to thank you for being here today. Rick, you and I had a chance to talk at your opening. I was your prep assistant that framed the bear piece for you, and I was lucky enough to spend a whole bunch of time with it. The energy in that piece is incredible. There's, I don't know what you put into that, everything. I can say to you, since working on that piece, a large black bear with a brown face comes down to my backyard every day and eats out of my garden. And I just wanted to know how that bear for you became the element of many of your pieces. In what way did his spirit become yours?
So much of our lives centered around the bear and ceremony, because the bear was the doctor, and it was also, it was our elder, our old man died, and in his loss, we really rever him as the bear, taught so many people and helped so many people getting off of drugs and alcohol. And the bear kind of impervious. These are, you can't get rid of it, it's always there. Dom Wu, the bear, Dom Wu. A lot of time now when we do them, we don't do the teeth. Now we are getting more on the side of medicine side, with the roots in our minds. The old man told us about the salmon. Said you're going to have to cry a lot and pray really hard a lot to get those salmon back in there. You're going to have to cry a lot, and you're going to have to pray a lot. And I just recently heard that the bear loves the salmon, but he's not like a tribe of people. He likes to eat quietly by himself. Consequently, he, she gets her salmon and then goes off back up the hill out of the ray from the river and finds a nice countryfolk place to eat the salmon. And while it's done properly, then we'll go find another one. And so the bears like to have privacy. They like to be left alone to have their meal. As the way we should be, not eating fast, we should go slow. And so the science have found out that the trees that where the bear likes to go rest now has more trees and more healthy trees growing where the bear likes to go rest and have his meals. So sometimes the best thing for us is to leave it the hell alone. They don't need it. Just a quiet place to have a good salmon dinner. Poop and leave the rest of us.
That's it.
I think we one final question, Joe, if you don't mind, just because it's for my youth. So maybe we can make the bridge happen here a little bit.
So I'm wondering if you think that the artistic world is going to go uphill or downhill from this point in time.
Artistic world is going to go uphill or downhill.
And do you think that the artistic world is going to go uphill or downhill? Do you think that people are going to keep having inspirations in nature, or do you think they're just going to stuck in their iPhones and looking at their TVs?
That's my grandson. So I'm going to try to answer. I've been watching you. I've been watching you on your path of discovery. Who am I? I see those impulses that you have to draw, and I see that hunger when you come and see Oma and me in our home of the river, and that's what I'm banking on, that the artistic impulse in a young person like you is fierce and is going to grow. And no two-dimensional screen on an iPad or a television is going to take that hunger away from you. I know that that's true, so I don't worry when you're looking at something on a flat screen that you've lost your interest in what's going on out there. And if I can, with your permission, I would like to tell a story about what you taught me once. You were less than a year old, and your grandmother and I watched salmon spawning in front of our house, and I wanted you to see that. We wanted you to see that. It's very powerful. And I held you in my arms, and I was standing at the edge of the river where the salmon were spawning. And I wanted you to understand. I know that you didn't understand my language, but it was like your grandmother and I were presenting you, whom we love, to these fish whom we love. We wanted you to get to know them. So, being your grandfather, you know, I was just going on. Explaining words like anadromous.
I don't know.
And I had the phone from the house, the portable phone, in my shirt pocket. And while I was going on about the mysteries of nature, you reached into my pocket and pulled that phone out and
and winged it down the Mackenzie River. See, they tell us that you had not reached the age of reasoning. But I believe you did. It was me that was out of line there. And when I turned around and looked on the bank, your mother was covering her mouth and terrified that what had happened, this phone got thrown into the river. But the truth was there in your grandmother, who was doubled over in laughter because she knew what that meant, and it was very funny. So you let us end on the note that Rick started us off on, which is one of humor, and I want to tell you again, I know you're bankable. I know that you are going to carry this tradition that Rick and I are trying to do a good job of. We see you right behind us, and we want to help.